Thank you. as far back as the mind of man can remember. As far back into the distant past as thought can recall, the desire has been there to lift oneself from Earth and fly. Fly like a bird. Stand on a hillside on a breezy day and lean into the wind, stretch out your arms and run a pace or two, and you're flying. Or is it just a dream, a fantasy, perhaps a far-off, distant memory of flight in some other time slot, in some other life, on some other planet? For those bound by circumstances and gravity to Earth, there's always the solace of projecting one's spirit at least aloft by proxy. Others find their freedom in the narrow confines of a high-performance sailplane. One of the most elegant forms of transport ever devised by man. If you do none of these things, you can listen and watch the drama of the approaching 727 and the drama of the undramatic RT. And after a day at the airport, listening to the laconic RT, seeing them in from Bahrain, Baghdad, Bombay and Brindisi, and home to bed, a chance to dream. Dream of flight could become reality here and now and on this planet. This is the nearest you'll ever get on this Earth to flying like a bird. so determined were the early aviators to lift themselves from the earth that many of them gave all they had because of their love of flying. This may be the first film ever without comic music on the soundtrack to accompany scenes such as these, for these were very serious attempts indeed. And from such experiments, experiments of trial and error, came the relatively stable Voisin, box kites and Blériots of the days before the Great War. The more successful of those early designs can be seen in the World Museums of Historic Aviation, gathering dust and smelling of glue and rotted fabric. But some museums are alive.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to El Warden for this, the second half of the first two-day flying meeting here at El Warden. We got somewhat better weather than yesterday, I think, and at least the sun is shining. And there, as you can feel right now, the wind is a little stiffer than we had yesterday, and may prove a little bit of a problem later on this afternoon.
Richard Ormond Shuttleworth was the son of Mrs. Shuttleworth, who lives in the house at the back of the airfield here. A bit of a young tearaway of the 1930s, who had a personal interest in an almost a mania for collecting private aircraft, vintage motor cars, motorbikes, and all forms of odd transport, with which he started to form a personal collection. His mother kept the collection going, and after the war, a trust was formed to his memory, the Richard Ormond Shuttleworth Trust, and aircraft have been added to this collection since then to keep the trust going, the prime aim of the trust being to keep aircraft in flying condition.
As one of the pilots of these veteran aircraft, do you find any special difficulties in the control of them?
No, generally most of the aircraft, being biplanes, have conventional aircraft controls. They have rudders, elevators and ailerons, just like any other modern aircraft. Being biplanes, they have the essential problems that go with biplanes, generally low roll rates, very sensitive pitch control and very sensitive rudder control, and very powerful rudders.
Has the Avro triplane got any special method of control? It differs from the normal aileron and rudders and elevators.
Yes, indeed. Roll control is by means of wing warping, as opposed to conventional ailerons. This makes the airplane rather difficult to control in roll and adds a few lateral and directional control problems as well. It's also a bit shorter directional stability, which makes it something of a pig to fly. It tends to want to fly sideways.
What is your particular favourite amongst these aircraft?
I think to answer your question directly, the Bristol Fighter falls straight into mind as being the airplane that's got the most powerful engine and therefore the airplane with which one can do most. It was designed as a warplane and as such is eminently aerobatic, has more power than it ever needs for most of the conventional flight regime. When you compare it with something like the Avro triplane, which has barely got enough power to keep it flying and has the odd control deficiencies as well, it makes answering your question very difficult, because I get almost as much fun out of flying the Avro triplane, difficult as it is, as I do out of flying the Bristol Fighter, easy as it is.
Wing Commander Herms, what did you think of the new Bristol Fighter aircraft when they first arrived on the Western Front?
Frankly, we thought they were bloody death traps. Our squadron got the first consignment of six, and we were so unused to them that on our first patrol over the lines, five out of the six got themselves shot down. Bloody disaster it was. Of course, we didn't really know how to handle them, didn't know their tremendous potential. Treated them like our old artillery observation aircraft, sort of defensively. But when we got used to them, by Jove, we didn't half knock hell out of the jetties. I remember I met up with a German false D-12 once, right over the German lines. Summer of 1918, I think. Or was it 17? Have a little trouble remembering dates these days.
Before the advent of the Fokker D-7, the Pfalz aircraft, a single-seat fighter of the Imperial German Air Force, turned out to be a very worthy match for McCutton and Rice Davids of No. 56 Squadron. After an inauspicious start, the Bristol Fighter became one of the most successful military aircraft of the period. Indeed, it was developed into the very first four-gun fighter. But the weight of the extra armament rather limited it to a maximum service ceiling of about 2,000 feet. So the experiment was discontinued. Many of today's Air Chief Marshals learned to fly on the Avro 504, and it was the mount for many royal personages' first solo. At the post by the Avro tutor, the Hawker Tomtit, designed to fill the role of a new type trainer for the Royal Air Force. Well, we all remember faith, hope and charity. It is, to the purist, an unfortunate fact that aircraft developed more quickly in time of war than in peacetime. At the start of the Great War, the British Expeditionary Force went to France with slow, unarmed aircraft such as the BE-2A, the Blériot, the Mono Avro, and the Maurice and Henry Farman, while the French used the Morane, the Voisin, and the Caudron. Only 3 years later, due to the pressures of war, these primitive aircraft had developed into relatively fast and highly maneuverable fighting aeroplanes such as the Sopwith Camel, mounting twin forward-firing Vickers machine guns. And so do we thank the gods of war, or curse them? Yet it was man that made the aeroplane a blessing or a curse. Even after only 2 years of war in the air, the Sopwith Pup Scout had a forward-firing machine gun and an 80-horsepower rotary engine, and was, by all accounts, a delightful aeroplane to fly. Early in the war, a very serious error of judgment was made by the Allied High Command in their complete lack of interest in an invention by a Dutchman, Anthony Fokker, of an interrupter gear which enabled a pilot to aim his aircraft at his opponent, firing forward through the blades of the revolving propeller without shooting it off. Both Britain and France rejected his design, but Germany, after a dramatic demonstration of air-to-ground firing by Fokker himself, accepted the scheme. The tragic result for the Allied Air Forces, the so-called Fokker Scourge and the Fokker Eindecker in the skilled hands of Oswald Belcher and Maxim Amann, inflicted very heavy casualties in the ranks of the Royal Flying Corps. And so, at the behest of the higher command, an English pilot and a German pilot set out to kill each other over the Western Front in 1916, when in other circumstances they might well have been the best of friends, as many of them were in the pre-war days of the international flying meetings, a friendship sealed by the common bond of the love of flying. Some 60 years later, another Dawn patrol, but this time flown for the love of it by the pilots of the Tiger Club of Redhill, searching the sky for expected intruders from some of the neighboring flying clubs, who, if they manage to sneak past the defenders and land at Redhill without having their registration letters noted, get a free breakfast on the Tiger Club. On patrol in his own particular sector of the defenses, keen eyes sweeping the horizon for intruders, a Tiger Moth from the old Battle of Britain Airfield at Redhill. And running in fast and low over the eastern boundary of the aerodrome, one of the intruders. Aha, what's this? A cunning enemy pilot trying to sneak in low between the trees. The intruder, nervous and on edge as well he might be with the Redhill pilots on patrol, twists and turns in his seat, watching for the defending aircraft. You. Yes, it's old ACDC thundering along with a full head of steam. Will he catch up in time before the stomp is across the Perry track? No, this time it's a free breakfast for the intruder, and ACDC returns ever vigilant to the patrol to deal with the next customer.
You have to turn, otherwise you'll just climb through the houses at the end.
And this time it's a victory for Redhill as a tipsy nipper fails to elude the net and has his number taken. What is it about these older aircraft which gives one an almost sensuous experience as your hand caresses the taut fabric? Is it just nostalgia, a seeking after one's lost youth amongst those who grew up with these sturdy biplanes of the 20s and 30s, with their aggressive look and their colourful squadron markings? Who can compare the lovely mathematical symmetry of a well-polished mahogany propeller with the odoriferous, scorched and blackened stovepipe end of a jet? And to those who grew up in the 1930s, do you remember the sound of a Hawker Hart landing? A sort of jangle of undercarriage compression legs and vibrating flying wires under tension as they took the strain. Perhaps the Wright brothers might have terminated their experiments at Kitty Hawk. Could they have foreseen the terrible destruction which was to be unleashed from their invention of the heavier-than-air machine?
Into the world an invention which would make wars practically impossible.
In the heart of the Surrey countryside, just to the southeast of Red Hill, is the Tiger Club. Unlike some flying clubs, there's a noticeable absence of wall-to-wall carpets, embroidered blazers, and empty gin glasses. And conversely, a noticeable enthusiasm for all aspects of light aviation.
Why did you form the Tiger Club in the first place?
Because I thought there was a need for a flying club which people would join who were devoted to flying from the sporting point of view. I think perhaps I can answer your questions best if I read you the Tiger Club aims and their charter. The Tiger Club aims are A, to provide the means of meeting for those who take an active interest in light aeroplane racing, displays, aerobatics, and other forms of competition. To provide its members with good sporting flying at the lowest possible cost. To work for improvement in standards of light aeroplane flying, aerobatics, and private flying generally. Our charter is that a member of the Tiger Club undertakes firstly, always go out of his or her way to assist other members in aeronautical matters. Second, always to fly with courtesy and with special attention to the safety and comfort of others. Three, never to use an aeroplane for any disreputable or unworthy purpose.
Map reading their way to Le Castellet or a dawn to dusk patrol won't start as usual. Do-it-yourself maintenance. This pilot takes size 11 shoes. You may notice that despite a lot of light-hearted joking and banter on the tarmac, there's a sudden change to quiet concentration on a pre-takeoff ground check. Touring is encouraged with the family. Dual aerobatics. Are they planning something new? Practice individual aerobatics for the coming season of flying displays at which the pilots and aircraft of the Tiger Club are much in demand. The Tiger Club also possesses one of the rather rare tiger moths on floats, the Sea Tiger. This aircraft was used in the BBC documentary film on the life of Sir Francis Chichester. trouble is, if you drop a spanner, you've got to go snorkeling for it.
Contact!
In an age of a multiplicity of magazines devoted to flying, why a new aviation publication? The founder of the Tiger Club, Norman Jones.
We wanted to start a magazine which was devoted purely to the sporting and pleasure side of flying, rather than the commercial side or the military side. We also knew that for every one person who could afford to learn to fly or to own his own aeroplane, there were literally hundreds who would like to. And as I remember very well, it's a great substitute actually for flying to read about it. And while you're reading about it, of course, you learn a great deal. And when eventually you are lucky enough to be able to fly your own aeroplane, you become a better pilot.
Switches off.
Throttle closed.
Throttle closed.
Throttle set.
Throttle set.
Contact.
Contact.
The Tiger Club also encourages the recently introduced sport of Formula One air racing. Just how does this type of air racing differ from handicap racing, which has been with us for 50 years past.
Well, Formula One air racing was originated in the United States and consists of a light aeroplane with 100 horsepower engines, all the same type of engine and built to a formula, which means that all aircraft built to that formula should have approximately the same speed. Therefore, in the racing, all the aircraft start level, and success in the racing depends a great deal on the skill of the pilot rather than the speed of the aeroplane. The race goes round a lap about 6 or 7 miles, always in view of the spectators.
It's a far cry from these neat little Formula One racers to the complexity of supersonics and electronics of the Royal Air Force. But both are linked by a common bond, the fascination of flying. Of the 50th anniversary of the Royal Air Force, the love of flying draws together pilots and air crew from all over the Commonwealth to Royal Air Force Station Abingdon, graced not only by so many colourful costumes, but honoured also by a visit from Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, whose husband and son are also pilots. yes, they can draw a girdle around the Earth at 18,000 miles an hour. Or they can cross the Atlantic in that sinister arrowhead Blackbird in an hour and 55 minutes. But they travel so fast that they're in danger of leaving their souls behind them. We call it jet lag. Should fly faster than 65 miles an hour and should be liberally adorned with a multiplicity of struts and flying wires, its own built-in headwind. But perhaps we might manage to compromise. A tiger moth, airborne from one of the little green grass airfields up and down the countryside, flying for the sheer love of flying.